From the Weather Channel, a special presentation. The allure of chasing tornadoes. Is it the advance of science, the call of adventure, the personal challenge, or the thrills? Every year, hundreds of Americans risk life and limb in pursuit of tornadoes. They prowl the plains looking for twisters, seeking that adrenaline rush dedicated to the chase. Tornado Alley, from central Texas to northern Nebraska, from eastern Kansas to the Rocky Mountains, it covers six states. Every spring, the wheat fields turn green, and cumulus clouds grow and reach toward the stratosphere. And 200 to 300 people pack their vans, turn on their scanners, warm up their modems, and hit the road. They're storm chasers.
Tornado!
You've seen their video on the Weather Channel for many years. So in 1995, we decided to join them in their pursuits and show you who they are and how they do it. And of course, those spectacular tornado videos that give us all a thrill. Stu Ostro, the Weather Channel's senior meteorologist and team leader, spent 3 weeks chasing storm chasers with our camera crew. Stu was raised in New Jersey. He'd never seen the killer storms of the Great Plains in person. His reactions to the experience are part of our story. But the storm chasers and their storms are the stars of this program. Let's start with Jim Leonard. Jim may be the most dedicated storm chaser in Tornado Alley. He moves to Oklahoma from his home in the Florida Keys every year for the whole tornado season, and back to Florida to chase hurricanes during the summer. He once moved to Guam just to see typhoons.
Chasing to me means everything.
Yeah, that sounds like a freight train.
Yeah.
Tuesday, May 23rd, near Childress, Texas, mid-afternoon.
It's real stratified up ahead here. I don't see anything exciting.
It might be the highlight of the day.
At about 7 p.m., with no rotation in the storms in our area, Jim called it quits. But to get back to Wichita Falls for the night meant passing through those non-tornadic storms, and they had their own nasty arsenal.
I thought we were chasing tornadoes, not hurricanes.
Jim's luck changed a couple of weeks later with chasers Bobby Prentice and Rich Thompson.
I can really see the motion of the dust coming into it.
It is tremendous.
The whole thing is a tornado. Oh, my God, that lightning lit up. Oh, wait a minute. We're getting close. We're getting too close.
Bobby. That's a lot closer than
we are. It's a lot closer. I think it's moving our way.
Turn south. We got to figure out where we are.
Okay.
Got the debris.
Go forward. Oh, wait a minute.
Go south, Bobby. South.
Go south. I mean,
or stop at least somewhere.
Hurry up, turn around, quick.
Get the roll.
It's turning right, fast.
Hurry up. Which way?
South.
Circulation.
Yeah, we're safe now. Look at this structure.
Get it. Shoot. Good. This won't be running away.
Shh. Yeah, keep quiet.
That is a nasty tornado.
Oh,
that,
no,
it's a big one.
Watch out, the rim of it's just over to your left. We're nuts, that's all.
Rushing the car close, but I know you like to live dangerously.
Storm chasers Tim Marshall and Gene Roden were in Texas during the same tornado outbreak. Tim is a well-known chaser and the editor of Storm Track magazine, the unofficial newsletter of the chase community. Gene Roden is also one of the best-known chasers in Tornado Alley. This was shot the day after the Allison, Texas tornado we just saw on video.
Well, Gene, what do you think?
Bobby's car was just a few hundred yards from Tim and Gene as this sequence of events unfolded.
What do you... Whoa! Oh, yeah, look at this! Well, it is, of course, interesting, because we're here. Bobby is going to get melted here. I think we're in fine. You know, Bobby. My Bobby's right there, okay?
We are too.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I think we ought to back up too.
Oh, you gotta turn around.
Whoa, you are. Gene, we gotta go forward or backwards?
I'm there.
Okay, Gene, stop. You're okay, stop.
All right.
Go down. Okay, keep going a little ways.
Neat.
Keep going a little ways.
Stuff, right? And these are experienced chasers. So before we continue our adventure, some words of wisdom from a pioneer storm chaser, and then tornadoes and baseball-sized hail. Stay with us.
Some luck, we'll have a forecast.
Dr. Chuck Doswell is one of a handful of pioneer chasers. A kind of chaser's guru. He works at the National Severe Storms Laboratory and is one of the most respected severe weather researchers in the country. Dr. Doswell takes chasing storms very seriously.
There's a whole host of things that increase the hazards associated with being on the road. Blowing dust, water on the roads. Occasionally, chasers have been known to travel at rates which exceed prudence under the conditions. All of those things increase the hazards from being on the road. Then, if you are ignorant about storms, it's quite possible that you could place yourself in a dangerous position simply through ignorance. Just wandering around, you could end up, for example, driving right in front of the tornado, not even realizing. Another important danger is associated with lightning. Being around thunderstorms, lightning gives essentially no warning. So being around thunderstorms in general, whether they have tornadoes or anything else, is dangerous. All of those things contribute to danger. And it's not the sort of thing that I would encourage people to do. In fact, I would discourage them from doing it if at all possible. And if they're going to chase, then what I recommend is that they spend time with someone experienced for a considerable amount of time before they try it on their own.
Our cruise chase day with Chuck Robertson was a three-ring circus with something going on all the time. The sky is blue and the sun is shining with a head east-northeast from Amarillo at about 1:30. It doesn't look like much of a day for storm chasing. The sun is still shining at 3 o'clock when Chuck pulls off the road just north of Pampa, Texas.
We're in a pretty good spot, really. Matter of having some patience, I think.
Other chasers leave for greener pastures, but Chuck tells Stu Ostro, we'll wait. Then the waiting pays off. It's 15 miles away, and it's wrapped in rain.
Okay, there may be a tornado northwest.
Tornado on the ground.
Tornado northwest.
Yep. On the left edge of the rain shaft.
On the left side of the rain shaft, yeah. Look at it now. Look at it
now. Oh, my God.
Oh, yeah, it's a big tornado. Very frustrating to see a big tornado, but we don't have roads to get us there.
Who all just saw the first tornado?
Oh, right here.
All right.
Yay! Good job. Good job.
There are storm cells developing all around. No time to gloat over the tornado, but plenty of time to search for another.
The weather channel being a little bit desperate to get out of the hail right now. We've got a very nice looking law found in the southwest, as you can see, but the tail is getting ferocious, and I really want to get out of this if at all possible.
Copy.
The hail lets up, and the caravan hits the road again. To the right, another tornado touches down briefly. The rain and hail pick up again. Back on the road, still more hail. Time to take shelter again.
Get out. I thought for once we finally got away from the hail, and then here it came again. Softball, but real good baseball.
Yeah.
This would do a number on your head if it came down. You would not want that.
Chuck Robertson's been chasing storms since 1978. His personal collection of tornado videos is very impressive. He shot this tornado the same day the Andover tornado hit near Wichita, Kansas.
Barry, take your eye away from the pieces. Just look at this thing.
I grew up in Oklahoma, and I've seen a lot of severe storm situations come through. And you know, after a while, not only grew up here, but also chasing 17 years, you just kind of get gut feelings about what's going on. And, you know, we have a lot of sophisticated computer models that predict what's going to happen, and the ones I can understand, I try to interpret as best I can. I definitely don't put priority on information like that. I'll put priority on more instinctive type information. Storm chasers kind of develop a talent and ability to drive with their knees, and that's kind of the way you do it. Oh, it's probably not quite as bad as it might look so far. Thank goodness I haven't had any accidents or anything, but it's one thing that you have to really do is really observe the traffic laws, and some might, you know, try to drive a little too fast, but it's really not worth it. There's other storms, other days, and I'd like to be around for those too.
Very large tornado. You can hear it roar.
I tend to be a solo chaser more than a group chaser. I enjoy chasing with other people as well, but something about being by yourself on a storm, it seems to intensify the experience. I do it for the thrill more than anything else. Just a thrill seeker, it's a hobby. It's a lot of fun.
If they don't say something soon, I'll call the weather channel.
Stu Ostro seems to agree. His chase with Chuck Robertson was the first successful one of his trip. And at the end of a day of dodging hailstones and pursuing tornadoes, it seems we have another meteorologist hooked on the chase.
two tornadoes, three funnel clouds, and how many thousands of hailstones later, quite a bit came out of it. An amazing day indeed. Hopefully tomorrow we do it all over again.
The high-tech chasing of Project VORTEX, next on The Chase.
We ran into some baseball, maybe larger size hail. We lost most of the front window and all of the back.
Even if you're chasing with the most sophisticated equipment and finest experts available, the risks are high. Project VORTEX is the largest tornado research project in history. During the spring seasons of 1994 and 1995, these 20 or so exotic-looking vehicles prowled the plains. Each one is equipped with sensors and telemetry equipment to measure and record the atmospheric conditions throughout a storm's environment. A jet aircraft records data above the storm. It's all designed in simple terms to find out what causes tornadoes to form. The operation is based at the National Severe Storms Laboratory in Norman, Oklahoma.
You also notice that there's a tendency for returning moisture over the high terrain of Old Mexico and West Texas. That shows up fairly clearly in this image. That may have an impact for tomorrow. If in fact this is a correct forecast, then by tomorrow we could have moisture, low-level moisture, returning to the high plains of West Texas. And it's possible that the circumstances could develop severe weather for tomorrow.
Forecasting for the VORTEX Armada is part of Chuck Dozzle's job on VORTEX. But he knows that the weather potential is only part of the decision to send out the Armada. It's costly and complex to deploy personnel and equipment for an undertaking of this size. Eric Rasmussen, field commander of Project VORTEX. The decision is his.
Okay, I might. Let me see what things look like here at the surface, and then I'll try to get some soundings deployed.
His job in the field is to coordinate all the VORTEX people and equipment, to get them near enough to the tornado to get the best data, but to keep them out of extreme danger. Eric is an enthusiastic storm chaser. He chased on his own throughout the 1980s. VORTEX is an entirely different kind of experience.
I would say the personal chases were a lot more satisfying. Going out and seeing tornadoes and filming them and enjoying the storm is really a thrill. VORTEX is incredibly hard work.
And the hard work has taught some lessons that, so far, have been surprising.
Oh, you know, going into VORTEX, I think a bunch of us here thought we had a pretty good idea about how to forecast tornadoes. And now, in hindsight, I think we don't know much about it. I really believe this, I think we're pretty darn good at forecasting supercells, when storms will be, rotating single updrafts. That seems to be pretty easy. But in terms of forecasting when that kind of storm might produce a tornado and when it won't, we're somewhere just beyond clueless.
Chasing tornadoes is often a case of hurry up and wait. The VORTEX Armada is in position for the day's chase. Now everyone waits for instructions on which way to go.
Our love is still a feeling in the morning.
Go ahead.
A radio sonde is sent airborne to take soundings on the upper atmosphere. And inside one of the VORTEX vans, Dr. Morris Wiseman of the National Center of Atmospheric Research watches as the results come in.
What we like to see is very rapid wind increases with height for tornadic supercell storms. Our threshold generally is about 25 meters per second over the lower 6 kilometers is in the range for tornadic storms. And today, for instance, over that lower 6 kilometers above the ground, we have about 35 meters per second of shear. So there's more than enough shear for supercell storms today and for big tornadoes.
The hunter becomes the hunted. Next.
On
underneath that stratus deck, you're trying to get somebody underneath to the north, there's some fairly respectable growing towers.
There were very few tornadoes in the Great Plains during the tornado season of 1994. Project VORTEX was funded for only two chase seasons. By June of 1995, they were desperate for data on tornadic storms. Then in the Texas Panhandle on June 2nd, all the elements came together.
Let's see if you can throw one.
Probe 1 is the member of the VORTEX Armada charged with getting into the core of the thunderstorm. That day in Friona, Texas, they accomplished their mission all too well.
See, look at that debris. It just blew off.
It tore down that mill, what it was. I saw the tower.
Okay, we're...
There's only one road through Friona, and Probe 1 is sharing it with an F4 tornado. Just caught its collective breath after Friona, when another large tornado reached out of the sky near Dimmitt, Texas. Once again, the chaser becomes the chased.
Large tornado on the ground stovepipe. Yeah. Yeah. Get going. Oh, close the door.
From a place of relative safety, Probe 1 watches in awe.
Just cross the road about a mile south of us.
That's beautiful.
Oh, my God.
I'm afraid it's going to max out. We might want to get a little further north, actually. Watch, keep an eye on that, Bob. Yeah, but it could max out. You know, it could get wider, and it could come out towards us.
Yeah.
No, you don't. But watch out for strong inflow.
If it can find you, which
is unbelievable. Yeah. Great. I'm not even zoomed in. I'll zoom.
How far away is it, you think?
This is about a half mile. I've never seen anything like this. How incredible. Oh, words can't describe it.
The Dimmitt tornado is now the most thoroughly documented tornado in history. VORTEX's video is breathtaking. But this is the kind of picture that most excites the VORTEX chasers. Taken by a mobile scanning Doppler radar designed for VORTEX by Josh Merman and Jerry Straka of the University of Oklahoma.
Seen before, seeing the eye and this it looks like a hurricane, but it does.
The brighter yellow right around the core here is the wall of the tornado itself, the outer wall of the tornado. And inside of here, there's no reflectivity. It's because most of the debris has been probably centrifuged out.
And this is the actual debris cloud.
That's the actual tornado right here. This is the wall of the tornado, or the funnel of the tornado.
See, we're so close that you can't even see the hook. We're so close. Basically, the hook extends here off of our data. We were probably under the hook or even inside the hook taking this data. The hook goes like that. So that's how close we got.
Incredible.
It's on the back of a truck, and we can take it and park it right near the mesocyclone and scan the storm like a normal ground-based radar would. And the data from that are just so exciting. You wouldn't believe those data.
Yeah, and that's only one element in the vast amount of information VORTEX generated for study.
After we're through in the field, we'll have somewhere between 5 and 10 years worth of data analysis work to do to really get all of the knowledge out of these data sets that we can.
I was very impressed with the way VORTEX goes about doing things. They have a very thorough briefing in the morning, and then I was also impressed with the way they actually do the chase and the way everything is so very well coordinated. Eric is under a lot of pressure in terms of having to make these second-by-second decisions, and I think he does a great job.
Next on The Chase, a married couple finds togetherness chasing storms. Betsy Abrams and Matt Crowther are both senior meteorologists at the Weather Channel. They're married, no kids, and live in Atlanta.
Power the wind.
They love severe weather. They own this storm chaser pinball game. Every year they take 2 to 3 weeks of hard-earned vacation to chase storms.
So that's just one of our vacations is a storm chase vacation. Actually, people say, wow, that must be a neat vacation. Well, it's fun, but it's also incredibly tiring. It can be, you can drive 1,000 miles in a day, get 4 hours of sleep, and then drive 1,000 miles the next day.
We hope we don't do that again. Last year we did that.
Once. You never know. Yeah, we drove 1,000 miles to miss a tornado by 5 miles last year, from Goodland, Kansas to Dallas, Texas, and the tornado was 5 miles away and we didn't see it.
The Weather Channel's crew ran into Matt and Betsy at what's called a chaser convergence. That's when several chasers happen to converge and trade information along the side of the road.
So if the mesocyclone is forming, it's
right in there, yeah. Right there. Right. Right where you got the little, and you almost have like a little, like I said, a very small, little rounded, like very, very small little rounded base.
That day's storms never developed, but Matt and Betsy's 95 vacation was fun filled.
Don't be that stupid mesocyclone that does dilly squat.
We're here.
Shoo, go on, beat it.
Get around, hit the road. Go away, horse.
Watch, the horse will block my view of the tree.
Horse.
A tornado wrapped in rain and other obstacles.
I need my still camera. Betsy, I want you to video, please.
Where's the zoom in on this, Matt?
It is zoomed in.
Okay.
Two small tornadoes today. Little flanking line jobbers.
That's
we
fine.
Better get going because we're gonna be eaten alive by this thing.
May 16th was an active day in Kansas, the best of Matt and Betsy's vacation so far. The audio went out on his camera during the sequence, but the video more than made up for it. There's a strong rotation in the wall cloud. The funnel lowers. Forms on the ground, and it's a full tornado.
We stumbled into this one.
Then the wall cloud reorganizes, and finally,
multiple vortex. I like it.
This is west of Sweetwater, a monster-sized storm, softball hail, supposedly a large tornado, but I think it's another cell. We're not even sure where that's supposed to be.
Oh, this is gorgeous.
Let's make sure that we have an out. See the edges. Very impressive storm. It's gusty there, though. It's
this is going through weird stages, what's happening. That's another flank back in that direction.
very complicated is what it is.
Oh, look at the gustnado right there. Gustnado on the ground. We have a gustnado on the ground. Windshield wipers, please. We gustnado on the ground. That's cool, gustnado. That's the best gustnado we've ever seen.
If this kind of vacation appeals to you, but you're not a meteorologist, again we urge you, don't go on your own. Often experienced storm chasers can be convinced to take you along, especially if you're willing to pay some of their expenses. And there's even one chaser, Marty Feely, who operates a storm chasing tour. Marty's the one in the hat. Next to him is Scott Fitzgerald from Arizona, and Harry McPhillamy from Ireland. Antonio Caridati from Brazil and his Japanese wife are also along. This is not a luxury tour. You pay $1,600, you sign an insurance release, and spend 2 weeks riding the plains in a van. There's absolutely no guarantee you'll see a tornado. Senor Caridati is 70 years old on his third tour and still hasn't seen a twister. Everybody has their fingers crossed for him. June 2nd, 1995, Dimmitt, Texas. This is Antonio Caridati's lucky day.
Remember this moment? Hey.
There's Antonio finally after more than 40 years.
Banzai! Banzai! Viva!
On the next to the last day of his tour.
Punching the core with Phelps and Blazer. That's next. Mike Phelps and Aaron Blazer chase storms for a living. That's Mike driving and Aaron riding shotgun. They've been chasing together for 5 years. They've seen about 65 tornadoes. Mike and Aaron live in Wichita, Kansas, and chase in a 400-mile area to the west. There's nothing they won't do to catch a tornado.
Our main objective is to see a tornado, and if it means core punching, we'll do it.
Because of their penchant for going where the action is, they've got a lot of wild stories to tell. Like the tornado they happened on near Lorain, Kansas in June of 94.
Kicking around lizards for a few hours, and literally, and we saw what the storms going up just to the west of where we were, so we thought, well, one of them looked pretty darn interesting, so we went after it and got into it, and this little tornado popped in the rain. No mesocyclone, just came out.
No wall thumb. Didn't match any of the classic ideas, and it wasn't a landslide.
And it was a trunk.
It was a strong tornado, came right out of the rain. And
we're like, we almost drove into it, but we're watching this heavy rain shaft just off, just kind of tooling around, and all of a sudden, it's like, whoa, we stop and get out.
And there's a tornado.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah,
I thought he was joking,
he was playing jokes
on me. There is a tornado.
And I'm like, whoa. So we got out, we were filming it, and it was a trunk. Came out of the rain, and then after it cleared the rain, it was moving south. Drifting right at us, just drifting for a little ways. But we were about a mile or so away, so we had some time.
No big deal.
And then all of a sudden it started moving west at about 50 miles an hour. It got hit by, as an outflow hit it, and it skinnied up and just tore west at about 50 miles per hour. And,
Weirdest thing I've ever seen.
Awesome stuff.
The Weather Channel's chase with Mike and Aaron started in Wichita about 9 a.m. Target, the Texas Panhandle, some 350 miles away.
It's only 353 right now, so we're going into max heating. So it's just going to become more unstable, by the hours. I expect by, 5 o'clock, we should have a pretty good sail to go after. At least that's what I'm hoping. Another hour and a half.
Hope it won't be in Del Rio.
I think we'll end up west Amarillo. All right, let's take it up.
At 4 o'clock, a tornado watch is issued for the Texas Panhandle west of Amarillo. This is a PDS watch, particularly dangerous situation. Mike decides to head west to intercept a storm coming in from New Mexico. It's about 5:30.
Okay, right. Storm continue punching south over. I keep an eye on this feature directly overhead. So very dangerous area here, so keep that in mind. Snap on any seat belts if you should have them.
3 miles down the road, the excitement really begins.
Large tornado on the ground, in the rain, not the best position.
Watch the motion here.
There you go.
Oh man, it's getting wrapped. Look how big that thing is. It's totally hidden now. There's no hopes of seeing it again unless we get in a better vantage point. Man. Yes! Woo!
Now the question is, where to next? There aren't many good choices. Storms are forming all around, and the only road leads directly into their paths.
No way at all. The way the storms have developed and the way they're moving, we basically found ourselves in a no-way-out situation. So be prepared. Things could get hairy in the way of large hail and high winds here pretty quick. And if it looks like we're going to get rolled by the RFD, we will pull over.
We are pulling over.
And hit hard they are. The vehicles begin to rock, and there's always the possibility of a rain-wrapped tornado appearing at any time.
Unfortunately, you may hate to say this, but unfortunately, get ready to dive.
So we do, go into the ravine?
We'll get away from the car. Run down, get away, a good 50 yards from the car.
Do we go against the hill, or what?
Oh, wow. Man, did you get that?
Oh. Phelps and Blazer are considering allowing paying guests to chase with them next year. Any takers?
After that experience, I thought maybe I'd had enough excitement for a while. But I can remember one time eating way too much cheesecake in one sitting and not being able to conceive of ever even wanting to eat again, much less cheesecake. Well, you know what? The next morning, I was ready to eat again, and lo and behold, I eventually began to get a craving for cheesecake again. I think it's the same sort of thing. As soon as I got back from our trip, saw a couple of radars with some incredible supercells on the radar, and the craving began to return all over again. So, like the man said, I'll be back.
Meanwhile, guess what Dr. Doswell of the National Severe Storms Lab did for his vacation?
Chasing is a time of the year for me when I feel like I have a sort of spiritual renewal. And without that, I tend to be grumpier than normal for the rest of the year until my next chase.
I'm hooked on storm chasing and I've got to have it. The worst time of the year for me is the period from like December through February. I just can't stand it. I mean, I'm just like, come on, I need a storm, and I'll go chase blizzards and snowstorms in Colorado to get my fix, so to speak.
Storm chasing may be scary at first, but once you see how beautiful a storm is, that beauty kind of overwhelms you. And it no longer becomes scary. In fact, a lot of people turn that scary, or fear, basically, of storms into just the overpowering curiosity that they have, which evolves into even further just an overwhelming sense of joy in chasing storms.
remember when I was 8, 9, 10 years old watching thunderstorms down in South Florida. We get them every summer quite often. And it was exciting to see those, you know, the lightning and the high winds and the heavy rain. It just, something about it, something clicked. I could never get enough of it.
This is a nice video. I'm in love here. I am in love.
Every tornado that I see is awesome. It's amazing to see. It never is to the point where I get used to it. I'm always amazed by it.
Okay.